This week on Secure Digital Life, Russ and I are going to talk about blacklist, whitelist, and the smooth, smooth flavor of Mac filtering that you can only get from Mac filtering. So hang around. We'll be right back.
This is a Security Weekly production.
Welcome to Secure Digital Life. And you type in AAA porn or whatever it is you're typing in. I was at a PG show.
And I'm really excited to be here.
I'm glad you're here because somebody needs to know what's going on.
That's right.
Okay, so now
somebody has to drink this.
It's another day. It's another episode.
Yeah, he's looking at the wrong camera.
You put my camera over here. Cut. Basically, forget you ever saw that. I think actually forgetting you ever saw that would really be a good idea at this point. Any con that's going to happen in Albany, New York, on June 16th to 18th, and we're going to go. So to Albany, which the time to go to Albany is in June. It's usually you see these conferences and it's like Albany in February, but it's actually in June, so it should be nice. Although it's a hacking conference, so you never go outside unless like DEF CON, where they have like people in the pool, like having contests where you got a laptop balanced on your lap, floating in the pool with two drinks, and you're trying to keep the drinks balanced, and you're floating on like a pool float with a laptop and going, yeah, okay. Which is a real challenge.
Wow.
If you want to talk about it. So that's coming up. If you're interested in that, check it out online. We'll put some more information up about that in the near future. We're going to be at Source Boston tomorrow. So we'll be there live at the Courtyard Marriott in Boston, Mass. Tomorrow, all day, I guess. I think we're scheduled to be there. We're going to do hacker movie trivia. Mm-hmm. We've got Paul's new glassware collection that we're going to put up. If you want to come by and try to win one of Paul's glass mugs to try to transport home with you, although it's not too bad if you're driving or the train. But
unless you're balancing a laptop.
And they got shirts and stickers and all that good stuff that you can come by at Source Boston and see us tomorrow. Today, Paul and company are at Source Boston. So if you're at Source Boston taking a break watching this, go ahead and check it out. Mm-hmm. Today's show is about blacklists and whitelists, and not the kind they had in the 30s, but it's kind of like that in some ways, but maybe not quite as biased, although, I don't know, mine are pretty biased because mm-hmm. I do go after people with extreme prejudice by IP address. Mm-hmm. And we want to talk a little bit about that and talk about Mac filtering, which is something you can do at home if you're concerned about that kind of stuff. I was going to bring up, before we talk about anything else, which is totally non sequitur off topic, was about ransomware. There was a story in Rhode Island yesterday, because the newspaper called me to ask me questions about it, and the Providence Journal was researching, sorry to scoop you guys, but you know, it's print media, what are you going to do?
They've been scooped.
Yeah, a law firm is suing their insurance provider because they got ransomwared. And trying to get that. So I went out and looked at some insurance policies to see, and I saw some that actually cover cyber extortion.
Really?
Yeah.
Does that fall under cyber extortion?
I'm not sure. Apparently it didn't with this law firm, or maybe they didn't have a policy, because I know a lot of people are starting to try to write cyber policies, because I was meeting with some people at a large insurance company not too long ago, and they were talking about, you know, they're developing cyber policies, and they're just trying to get a handle on, like, what should we insure? You know, it's not like regular insurance where you're thinking about, well, it's a crash or a fire or a bomb or a flood or whatever.
There's
it's
no tangible asset.
And it's just stuff that changes just constantly. So it's more like malpractice insurance or something like that. Mm-hmm. But it's very complex, or errors and omissions type insurance that you might have. So check those stories out, because if you don't know about ransomware, we'll do a show about it real soon, because you should know about it and you should be scared of it. Ransomware affects everyone. This is your brain on ransomware, and we could just turn the cameras off right there, but we didn't have that plan. So let's talk about blacklist a little bit, and why that stuff comes up. So in the old days, the way this worked was pretty much all systems were just wide open, and even commercial systems. So in the old days, I'm not talking about like, you know, the 30s. I'm talking about like 1998, 1999. And everybody just ran their systems open, because the idea was that nobody is out there, that there's no threats. And one of the most popular things ever that was being used was called anonymous FTP. And people use this to allow people to share files. So a lot of gamers, a lot of other people started sharing files by just finding these anonymous FTP sites. And a lot of them didn't restrict your access very much. You could just connect and put files on there, and other people come along and look through the list of files and download whatever they wanted. And there's still these things today. Anonymous FTP turned into like a hack fest because it was a way to get onto the system, which is just hacking 101. And by getting into the system, you could start trying to escalate. And there was a lot of FTP demons that didn't have good security. They had exploits. They had et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And all that stuff added up to anonymous FTP going away for many, many reasons, but all of them pretty good. Of course, today we still have anonymous websites. I mean, most websites you use are anonymous. So when you go to CNN or you go to whatever you go to, you're connecting to an anonymous site that does maybe track your IP, but it doesn't really know who you are. Mm-hmm. And most of them have to be like that because that's the whole point of the internet. So if you had to create an account and log into everything, it would get to be a bit tedious. Right. What happened was, as attack vectors started to materialize against my servers or your servers or whomever's servers, people realized that they need to close all the doors. And that really led to the earliest kind of this stuff, which is called whitelisting. So at home, so when you're using these kind of devices at home, they're usually set up by default to be blocked. So nothing comes in except traffic you is replying to you. But a lot of times we've talked about people open ports on these systems. People want to share files. They want to share video. They want to share their printer. They want to there's all these things you can share now. Cloud printing and all these kind of VPNs and on and on and on. And so what happens with that is you really want to be sure that you're sort of protecting yourself by using whitelists, which when a whitelist means everybody's blocked and I'm only allowing people that I trust. So I'm going to pick some things and trust them. That's almost impossible to do with CNN. So what they have to do is they have to use blacklists. And blacklists mean that you get put on a blacklist if you misbehave. Mm-hmm. So by causing enough problems, you get on my blacklist on the networks that I support. And I have this big, long, huge list of people that I've blacklisted over the years. And so people that are scanning me, people that are doing bad things, and they get blacklisted and blocked. Have you used any of this?
Yeah, we have at XYZ College, we have had our wonderful IT department has actually blacklisted or established a complete blacklist of IP addresses of websites, if you will, or collections of websites that are somehow doing nefarious things that are not in line with, you know, the mission of XYZ College. So what they do is they take those lists and they give them to the network admin, and the network admin puts them on as blacklisted on the router, so they can't get in.
And yeah, I mean that's a pretty standard practice. I mean, you'll see that at most any enterprise business, so that you can go in and block known things. And you can get these lists. I'm going to talk a little bit about that later, about some ways you can acquire these lists of bad things. A lot of times, though, the bad people are just incidental. Mm-hmm. So I'll get a lot of attacks that are just coming from, like, an IP address. Mm-hmm. And I'll go block that IP address, and you'll sometimes see the person immediately change their IP address.
Yeah.
And by changing it, they get. And when I say change it, if you're in a internet cafe, which is something they have in Asia that we don't have as much of here, but even if you're at Starbucks, you have an IP address that gets assigned to your machine when you connect. So that gets sent to you automatically. To get a new one, what people will do is they go to the command line and they sit there and they type, like on Windows, they type ipconfig/renew, and they just hit enter until they get another IP address. Mm-hmm. And so then they come back and they hit me again. Mm-hmm. And so then I may actually back it up and block the first 24 bits of a certain IP address string, so that whole network gets blocked out. And that can cause problems. I mean, if you're an enterprise and you start blocking. One time I got so angry with these guys, I ended up blocking it like at 16 bits. Mm-hmm. And I ended up blocking like Western Europe. And I got all these calls, and I was supporting a conference. And all of a sudden, all these people are calling, going, I can't register. I can't get in. The website's down. And it's like, oh, where are you located? And like, I'm in France. Like, oh, yeah, France is out. We're not doing that anymore.
To sort of break it down even in a more simpler terms, but I've been getting a lot of phone calls from unwanted numbers over the last five or six weeks on my iPhone. And so what I've been doing is blocking them and then deleting the voice message that they leave. You know, oh, your home is worth more money than you think it is. You know, please refinance now. Call us at blah, right. So then I would block them, and then I go on the my carrier's website, where you can block them there even further. So that they can't get around it. What they're doing is they're not calling you from these actual cell phones that have these numbers. They're calling you from like Skype or some other VoIP service, and they're spoofing the exchange and then the area code and then whatever XYZ number.
Right.
So eventually they're going to come up with something that's white, that's not blacklisted, and then they'll be able to get through. So.
Yeah, and you can block a lot of stuff that way. Nothing's perfect, right. And if you're using blacklisting to prevent people getting in, they can always change their IPs. They can use Tor, we've talked about on the show, to get like random IPs from all over the world. They can use all kinds of mechanisms and tricks to use. I mean, all they got to do really is pack up and go to another Starbucks, and then they've got a whole new network address. At home, what you need to be doing is you need to be whitelisting. So you typically have blacklisted to the max, so everybody's blocked. As you start thinking about allowing people to access your resources at home, you really need to seriously think about whitelisting, because you only should allow people into your home systems that you trust. And if that means that's you from work, then fine. Allow that network component to come into your network from home. If you are accessing it from abroad, or you're through a cloud, or you've got printing, or whatever it is you want to do, find out what that is, find out what that service is, and then allow that in. And a really good way to do that is what we recommend to people and companies, is to learn your network. And for people at home, that's often pretty challenging. But a lot of times what you do is just get logging going on your little router. And all these routers will do logging. And start watching. And you can do this by allowing the traffic in and then watching where it comes from, and you can get that information and then put in and build a whitelist out of it. Mm-hmm. And that would let you then have a much more secure network, because you're not just saying anybody can come to that port. Because if you leave that port open, somebody will come knocking on the door. And if they do that, then you may have a real issue in your home network. So that's kind of, I guess, what I wanted to say about that particular thing. Let's talk about MAC addresses then. Mm-hmm. Now, some of you may not know what a MAC address actually is, and so I'll give you a quick rundown. A MAC address, every device that is got a NIC in it. Network interface card. So anything that's got ports on the back of it has MAC addresses. And a MAC address is 48 bits long. So that's what those look like, and they're written in hexadecimal. So you'll see them, and the protocol standard is that they'll be on the back of this device. So you would actually find the MAC address for this particular device in the back. Now, a lot of phones and laptops and things like that don't have that stuff printed on them. You could probably find it.
Yep.
A lot of times on phones, you have to take the phone apart to find it. It's printed on a piece of paper that's inside the phone or something like that.
Or in the settings. Yeah.
But you can go in the settings and see what it is. On a Windows machine, you could type ipconfig/all, mm-hmm. and it will show it, and it's listed as the hardware address.
Yep.
So you could actually see the hardware address of the Wi-Fi card for that machine.
And your machine may have more than one if it has multiple NICs.
Absolutely.
So if you have a wired NIC, that would have its own MAC address, and then your Wi-Fi card would have its own MAC address, and your Bluetooth card would have its own MAC address.
And if you have any virtual connections like VPNs or stuff like that, or VMware or any other kind of stuff on your machine, it may have created additional virtualized NICs, and each one of those is going to have a MAC address. This is called layer 2 addressing, mm-hmm. if you've ever heard anybody say that. But layer 2 is only within that network segment. So it's in that local network segment. No routing is involved or anything like that. But these MAC addresses, theoretically, are used as unique identifiers of every single device. And in theory, anyway, you can't have two MAC addresses that are the same in the same network segment. Now, my suspicion is, of course, that people that make NICs probably reuse them, but they make sure they're not in the same batch or whatever. And so, you know, the likelihood you'd get two of the same is, I've never had it, and I've had thousands of NICs around, and I've never seen anything like that. The first 24 bits mm-hmm. of the MAC address, do you know what the first 24 bits is?
Would that be the manufacturer?
Oh, very good. So, see, Russ knows his stuff here. The first 24 bits is a manufacturer's identifier. Mm-hmm. So Netgear will have one. Cisco has a whole bunch of them. Netgear probably has a whole mm-hmm. bunch of them, too. But you can look those up, too. So if mm-hmm. you see MAC addresses in the wild, meaning you're looking at logs mm-hmm. or you're looking at something, you may be able to actually say, that's a Cisco device, or it's an Apple device, or it's whatever it is. And that can help you actually identify MAC addresses that are in your environment as well. So the reason that MAC filtering happens is you have a Wi-Fi network. I mean, I would say that if you're watching the show, you probably have a Wi-Fi network at home or in your apartment or somewhere, or you go to Starbucks or whatever. But if you're managing a Wi-Fi network, one of the huge risks is that people will piggyback onto your Wi-Fi. And we've already talked about setting up Wi-Fi security, so using passwords and things like that. That helps to limit who can get on. If you use MAC filtering, and you can use this on wired networks too, if you use MAC filtering, you further limit the ability. Now someone can't even try to connect. They can't try to guess your password. They cannot get into that network at all. So I know you were saying you have a guest network.
Yeah.
So on a guest network at home, you probably don't have MAC filtering. Mm-hmm. You say, I don't know what these MACs are, so yep. I'm just going to let anybody who wants to use this network use it. And it's the Wild West.
Yep.
But you've got a private network mm-hmm. sitting there that you got your stuff on, and you say, I'm not going to allow those people that are visiting me to even try to connect. They're not going to get a message saying password or whatever. Right. It's just going to be blocked. Mm-hmm. And that's called MAC filtering. And it works exactly the way blacklisting works. So by going in there and putting a blacklist on there, you're blocking layer 3 IP addresses. Mm-hmm. MACs mean you're blocking layer 2 MAC addresses. You're cutting them out at the connectivity level. And this is a very heavy-duty filtering technique. Mm-hmm.
I use it at home, on my, like you were suggesting, on my private network, because I just don't want the Wild West on. I keep my network separate, and then the stuff that I want to protect, you know, I've got files on here that if they got out, it'd be a nightmare. So I set up the MAC address filtering, and when you do that, if you decide to use MAC address filtering, you got to make sure that you do it for each of your devices. So my PlayStation 4, my PlayStation 3, my Xbox, all my cell phones, all my tablets, my Google Glass, my HoloLens. So it can get a little cumbersome, but once you do that, you know that you've additionally added an additional level of security that is welcome.
And it's not very hard to do. Right. I'm going to actually make a demo and put on the wiki later. We didn't have a demo today, and I'll make one later and we'll put it on the wiki if you're interested in seeing how to set some of that stuff up or what it looks like. Mm-hmm. But the easiest way to do it is literally just to log in your router like we've been doing on the show mm-hmm. and look at if you go in there and look, you can see the DHCP the DHCP devices that have connected. And I'll show you that in the demo. Mm-hmm. And you can see what all's there. And it will show you their MAC addresses as well. Mm-hmm. And that means you can also then put in a DHCP reservation. So you can assign IP addresses to all these devices like your phones so that every time my phone is in my network at home, it gets the same Wi-Fi address. Right. So that means that I know where it is in the network. I can reach it too, mm-hmm. but I also know what those things are when I see them. So we have TiVos, and we have a doorbell. We have TiVos. We have all this different stuff. I have several different wireless routers that talk to each other. All that stuff, I like to be able to see what it is in my router's log. So by being able to do that, I could keep people off. And I live in a neighborhood where there's lots of houses. If you've never popped open your networks, and looked to do it, it's pretty interesting. And you'll see there's lots and lots of networks around there. By default, these devices connect to the strongest signal mm-hmm. that is out there. So that means if your neighbor puts up a big honking machine that's got a lot of high-powered antennas, you may start connecting your network's neighbor. And if you do the same thing, they may start connecting to you. Because I've seen that a lot. Mm-hmm. We had a really powerful network because I was broadcasting to my offices. And I saw my neighbor's devices start trying to connect to my networks. And I had to be sure they were all blocked out because I don't want them getting on there. I don't think they were trying to do anything nefarious. Right. But there was a case in upstate New York where where the guy was actually downloading child porn using his neighbor's Wi-Fi. And he was doing it on purpose to try to prevent from getting caught. And he didn't get caught. His neighbor got arrested, and it's kind of sucked. So it's the more restrictions you place around this, it's a little bit of a hassle to set up because now instead of it just being Wild West, you've got that when your friends or your family or whoever comes to visit, they're all going, why can't I get on your Wi-Fi?
Yeah,
it's like, you're not allowed.
Yeah.
It's like, that's what I tell them. It's like, you're not getting on my Wi-Fi.
Oh, just set up the guest like I do.
I don't care if you're related to me. It's like, I'm not letting you on here. It's like, it's a fee.
Yeah.
It's $19.95 a day like they charge at the Marriott.
Or a bottle of scotch.
Well, or a bottle of scotch would work too. Yeah, any of those things.
One of the things too, we want to make sure that they know, the audience knows, is you know, it's not a one and done thing. It's not like where you just want to sit there and say, well, should I use WPA2 encryption or should I use MAC address filtering or blacklisting or whitelist? No, it's the more of these that you can add, the less of a problem that you're going to have later on in the future, because it's important to piggyback these things.
And security is always about layers. Yep. I mean, that's one of the basic tenets of all security, is that That's why you have a fence and you have a guard and you have a dog between the fence and you know, and you have a camera in the lobby. Mm-hmm. Because any one of those things may be circumvented either by accident or because it fails. And the same thing goes with your networks. So the more these things you block, the happier your life's going to be, because you will be a less of a target. And like I say, a lot of people at home say, oh, Doug, come on, you know, I don't really do all that fancy stuff. And then I start asking questions going, do you use Sony PlayStations? Mm-hmm. Are they connected? Are you allowing people to come in and connect? Are you hosting games? Are you doing these kind of things? And the next thing they know, they go, well, yeah, I went in there and I set something up. And, well, yeah, you opened a port on your router. Mm-hmm. And now anybody could connect to that because they're looking for those ports. And so having MAC address filtering as well as other approaches. Now, you can't use MAC address filtering for people outside your network, understand. It only works for people that are inside your network. So people on the internet will be not affected by MAC address filtering. That's where you have blacklists and whitelists and all those things. Mm-hmm. Inside, though, if you have friends coming over, if you live in a dorm, if you live in an apartment building, and I assure you, if you're, you know, any of those places, somebody will try to use your network because they go, hey, I can get free internet. I don't have to pay for it. I'll just jump on this guy's network right here.
Before I added any of these security features, I used to get emails from my router telling me, hey, there's some sort of unauthorized access going on. Oh, you've just been pinged, you know, by 1,700 in 30 seconds, which they'll, you know, hackers will use a script or script kiddies will use a script to do that they can easily download. But since I employed a lot of these methods of security, I don't get those emails anymore.
Well, if you look at your router logs, you'll see you're just constantly being barraged at home by people scanning.
And that's normal.
Yeah, it is normal, and you don't need to panic about it, but they're out there looking for ports that are open, like PlayStations or anything that there's a known exploit in, and some of these are just people that have no idea what they're doing. They're looking for easy targets, like anonymous FTP, or they're very sophisticated attackers who are looking for certain devices that can be exploited, like DVRs and things like that, thermostats and all this kind of fun
refrigerators.
Stuff that you see. If refrigerators, you know, if they can compromise all those things, it could be pretty interesting. And last thing, then, I wanted to bring up to you just a couple of products that are free. And I don't get paid to advertise these products, and they don't charge you anything to use them. One of them, I've set up a lot of these for enterprises, is Dan's Guardian. Mm-hmm. And I've built quite a few Dan's Guardian boxes for enterprises. And these actually provide blacklists that are dynamic. So they have huge sections of lists, and you can go in and choose, you know, I want to add this list. Like the last time I set one up, we were filtering pornography. There was just like a whole list of pornography. And, you know, every day it would connect and download new lists of additional sites to prevent people in your network from going out onto the internet and connecting to sites you didn't want them to. And you may want to do that kind of stuff at home. Dan's Guardian had a list of things like ticketing. So you could block people going to Ticketmaster or StubHub.
Wow. Yeah.
They had lists for everything. You could block CNN on Dan's Guardian because a lot of companies were worried about productivity and they blocked Netflix and they blocked YouTube and they blocked
Facebook,
all those kind of things from work.
Social media.
And at home, you may want to block things too. And Dan's Guardian is a pretty good way to do that, because if you jump on Dan's Guardian and just block all the pornography, somebody in your home is not going to be able to get out onto the internet and look at pornography from there. Or your school, if you're watching from a school. I set one up in a high school once just because they had no idea how to filter, and the students all kept getting around Net Nanny. It's so easy to do.
Yeah.
I know a trick, and all the kids knew it too. And the guy that was at this school, this was
a proxy.
It was in another state. Oh, they weren't doing that. They were. I got to tell you. If you take an IP address, take the IP, the four pieces of an IP address, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. Convert the whole thing to a 32-bit binary number. Mm-hmm. Convert that to a decimal number. Mm-hmm. Type http://, and put that decimal number in. Mm-hmm. It'll go to the website.
Oh, no kidding.
And guess what NetNanny doesn't do? We just told everybody in the world that it'd be that's, well, too bad. But use Dan's Guardian instead. The other one that I have fooled around with is called Squid Guard. And Squid Guard basically does the same thing. These are dynamic blacklisting services you put at your border. They run on Linux boxes, so you can set up a Linux box for really cheap. They don't have to be super powerful for home use. And you can literally proxy all your traffic through Dan's Guardian or Squid Guard as it goes out on the internet. And it will put up a message that here's the last one. I did this thing for a company, and we were blocking traffic. And whenever you went to something you were supposed to, we put up a message. And it said, you have attempted to go to. And then it said, please write an explanation for why you tried to go to this site. And we were reading the explanations, and it was hysterical. radical. There were people in there going, I need to go to ESPN each day because I feel like I have to get in touch with my clients. I want to know their state of mind and if their local sports teams were. And it's like, and is that also why you needed to go to cheerleaders.com? But regardless, these are all things that you really ought to probably be looking at. There's links to a lot of these sites on the wiki. So if you want to check out Dan's Guardian or Squid Guard, those are cool tools that are free. Mm-hmm. They don't cost you anything. So that's definitely the way to go. You can set up a Dan's Guardian box literally on an old piece of hardware or even a virtual machine and proxy it. And it will cost you literally just the price of an old machine that you've got sitting in your storeroom or something, or that you bought off eBay or whatever. Just wipe it real good first. Anything you want to add to that?
No, I think that's pretty good.
All right. So we'll see you tomorrow at Source Boston if you're going to be there. If not, well, we'll see you next week on Secure Digital Life. Thanks for tuning in. See you around.
Take care.